Macmillan Australia Audio and Belinda Audio present this unabridged recording of Great Australian Sporting Stories, written by Ian Heads and Norman Tasker and read by Chris Chapple. How these curiosities would be quite forgot did not such idle fellows as I put them down. John Aubrey, English writer and philosopher. Foreword. Ian Chappell, former Australian cricket captain. I made my Sheffield Shield debut in February 1962 at the Adelaide Oval against the all-powerful New South Wales team, captained by Richie Beno. Times were different then. You paid your bills in pounds. The Beatles were an unknown band working in Liverpool, and more than 10,000 fans attended on the Saturday of that Shield match. The players of all sports in that era had day jobs, and journalists like Norman Tasker and Ian Heads covered many different sports. In more than 60 years of covering a variety of sports, both Tasker and Heads have gathered together a multitude of stories, all of which embody their similar attitude and commitment to the task of communicating to the public what the game is all about. I first met Tasker in the 1960s, but I really got to know him on the Australian cricket team tour of the UK in 1972. It was a joyful tour, and an important one for a developing team. The importance of the tour was emphasised by the strength of the media contingent following the team. A group shot, arranged by photographer Russell McFedrin, features Richie Beno and Jack Fingleton, two former Australian players and renowned journalists. Then there was the voice of Australian cricket, the ABC's Alan McGilvray. The array of newspaper journalists was a strong one, including Tasker, Mike Coward, and Graham Darcy Eccles, or as he was also known, the famous Eccles, after the character of the same name in The Goon Show. It was a talented and colourful group, and there was great respect and rapport between the team and the media contingent. This was in a period when cricket writers were welcome in the home dressing room during tests and Shield matches. There were two unwritten rules regarding these visits. The journalists would not divulge any private information gleaned in those moments, and they had to bring beer. Each team was only supplied with 12 bottles of beer, one for each player, and consequently, it was a BYO establishment for the journos. Such was the respect between players and journalists that Rod Marsh would remove the top from a bottle of beer and place it in his locker at tea time. This was for the world-renowned writer Ray Robinson, who was a diabetic and could only drink flat beer. Having toured the UK in 1972 with Norman the Foreman Tasker, I had the pleasure of repeating the ritual in 1977. Only this time I was sitting with him in the press box. This was at a time when Kerry Packer's World Series cricket was in its formative stages, and it made for interesting and occasionally challenging times as a journalist. Not long after that tour, I had another opportunity to mix socially with Tasker. He was coach of the Gordon Rugby Club, and our mutual friend John Fordham was the social secretary. He described himself as team manager, but we knew better, and I was invited to speak to the players after training. As you would expect from a club known at the time as the Gay Gordons, it was a highly sociable Thursday night, but that didn't stop the club amassing a record-breaking win on the Saturday when they accumulated a century of points. Our relationship continued when Tasker asked me to write for the cricket magazine then known as Inside Edge. Tasker was easy to work for. He had good ideas for stories and always aimed for a high-standard magazine. The thing that has always stood out with Tasker is his fairness as a journalist and his decency as a human being. He was not afraid to write the difficult stories, but I've never heard anyone utter the words, "I was dudded by Norman Tasker." Starting out in Adelaide, I didn't meet writer Ian Heads, who by then was covering mainly rugby league, until I arrived in Sydney to live. The first word that comes to mind when I think of Heads as a journalist is prolific. Whether it be newspapers, Rugby League Week magazine or books, Heads is never idle. His collaboration with Tasker on the book that depicted the fulfilling life of Richie Beno was a classic example of hard work and diligent dedication to the task. That book is not Heads' only cricket work of note. He collaborated with Mark Taylor on a book full of the insights you would expect from a daring captain working with a tireless co-writer. The list of people who have engaged Heads to work on their book reads like a who's who of sport, covering a wide variety of games. In addition, Heads is a superb historian, and his thoroughness and credibility has earned him great respect and many plaudits. Having had so much experience in the media world, I know readers will enjoy the many stories and anecdotes that the pair have accumulated over more than a century combined in journalism. Of special interest to me are accounts of their early years in journalism, when the newspaper game was a highly competitive and colourful place. Introduction. On quiet afternoons in the sun, Ian Heads and Norman Tasker still do a lot of talking about sport and its characters, journalism and its jollies, life and its laughs. They've each been at the coalface for nigh on 60 years and have seen plenty, that's for sure. They met at the old Daily Telegraph when the Packer family ran it. It was 1961. Tasker had been there since 1959, but was relatively new to the sports staff when Heads arrived, and they have shared much since. Even now, as relatively active septuagenarians, they attend a weekly strength training class and do lunch, perhaps more often than they should. Ian wrote rugby league mostly, covering several kangaroo tours in the days when Australian league teams traversed the north of England and France for several months. He still considered the game's premier authority and historian. He was managing editor of Rugby League Week for some of its best years, and he initiated the Immortals. He also covered four Olympic Games and provided mountains of copy on swimming, from Dawn Fraser to Ian Thorpe. More recently, he has written some 50 books. The Heads' literary archive stretches from histories of games and clubs to biographies of leading sporting figures. A rich and expansive trove, it defines sport's place in the Australian way of life and paints the breadth of its characters. Ian has been widely honoured for his work, earning an OAM along the way, being inducted into the Sydney Cricket Ground's Media Hall of Fame, and being honoured with Lifetime Achievement Awards by both the Australian Sports Commission and the NRMA Annual Kennedys. Norman Tasker began at the Daily Telegraph as a copy boy. He wrote rugby league for a couple of years in the early 1960s, but spent most of his career covering rugby union and cricket. He was recruited by the afternoon paper The Sun in 1967 and remained there for 20 years, including a stint as sports editor. Norm made four long tours with Wallaby teams back in the amateur era and a couple of Ashes tours with the Australian cricket team. He also wrote sporting scripts for the television program This Is Your Life and followed Heads as the managing editor of Rugby League Week. He wrote many articles for The Bulletin and for several years was the magazine's sports editor. He also launched the cricket magazine Inside Edge and established a contract with the Australian Rugby Union to publish test match programs, which has survived for more than 20 years. He has written 13 books, four of them in collaboration with the great cricket commentator, Alan McGilvray, and two in partnership with Ian Heads. This book has come about because both these titans of Australian sports media felt the need to tell their stories, and it seemed like it might be fun. History is all too easily lost, great times and great people too easily forgotten. The authors lived through much change and much upheaval. In the beginning, nobody played sport for a living. The game was the thing. Television and its moguls, professionalism and the business of sport have all entered the picture and changed it markedly since they started writing about people playing games. In a cricket match in South Africa, a young man tries to rough up a ball with a small piece of sandpaper. Television cameras with extremely long lenses are at the ready for just such an indiscretion, and the young man is pinged. As the dust settles, the umpires inspect the ball. No damage. Play on. The game in question, of course, was a test match between Australia and South Africa, and this was universally considered a clear case of cheating. Ineffective cheating, since the Aussies weren't doing all that well, but cheating nevertheless. All hell broke loose immediately after the game and for weeks thereafter. Cameron Bancroft, who used the sandpaper, was suspended for 9 months. The captain and his vice-captain were suspended for a year and lost personal sponsorships and playing contracts in India. Total losses in the millions. Sponsors withdrew from cricket at considerable cost to the game. The Prime Minister was on the phone demanding severe action. Acres of newspaper space and hours of television time were devoted to the whole affair, relegating actual life and death crises to an afterthought. What the whole thing did say was that Australians take their sport very seriously. They identify with it. And if a line is crossed in what is thought to be right and fair, we all feel guilty. There is a distinct injury to the national conscience. Then there is the commercial aspect. The official reaction had to be severe in order to preserve the game's standing in the minds of sponsors and those who provide the money. Sport is big business these days, and the game's imagery is important to the business. Maybe that was the problem in the first place. Winning was just too important, and by whatever means necessary. There is no doubt that the one overarching change in sport in the time that Ian Heads and Norman Tasker have been writing about it is the metamorphosis from a Saturday afternoon pastime to big money business, with all its attendant pressures and compromises. Once television brought it all into the home and turned it into a universal public entertainment, it was inevitable. Heads and Tasker were there as it happened. The eruption that came with World Series cricket in 1977, turning a comparatively sedate sport of gentlemanly bearing into a cutthroat affair in which, as Kerry Packer so delicately put it, the devil could take the hindmost. They were there when Super League came along, with the added impetus of the new pay TV and the battle between Packer and his similarly determined mogul rival Rupert Murdoch. That was the clincher. It was the 90s, and social changes on every front aligned with the pressures on sport to change the landscape forever. In August 1995, Tasker wrote a cover story for The Bulletin, which made the point and still makes the point. The cover headline over a picture of Rod Laver holding the Wimbledon trophy said, "Goodbye to all this. How big money is changing the face of Australian sport." He wrote, "Sportsmen were our most substantial heroes, the glue that held us together through hard times. They were the focus of our national achievement, and they gave us standing on the world scene that no other field of national endeavour outside of warfare could provide. Individually, they were role models who set standards of competitive striving to which all young men and women aspired. They set our national ideals of sportsmanship, of group responsibility and mutual respect, of grace in victory and defeat, of dignity under pressure. The game was the thing. Sport entailed attitudes of selflessness that made giving more important than taking. Material reward was rarely significant. Names like Don Bradman, Rod Laver, Ken Rosewell, Dawn Fraser, Clive Churchill, Ted Whitten, Herb Elliott, Betty Cuthbert. Even animals like the great racehorse Gunsind seemed to underscore a national identity embracing courage, dedication, and an air of quiet modesty in supreme achievement. Now, material reward seems to be all there is. There is public disenchantment that sport has become little more than a marketing tool for commercial forces, and that sportspeople have become greedy accomplices for whom an arrogant disdain for tradition and old values is almost a prerequisite. Commerce has hijacked us on all fronts. Australia looks back over a rich sporting heritage. As a relatively small country, we have produced a disproportionate number of champions over a wide range of pursuits. Australian sports stars have always been held up as fierce combatants and honourable competitors who maintain in their chosen sports the laid-back notion that the game is to be enjoyed no matter what. Most of our current sports people continue to embrace those philosophies, but many do not. And in an era when sport has become a utility for sale and a vehicle for commercial exploitation, that is a worry. These stories trace that transition. We can remember when top-ranking footballers would play a test match on a Saturday, back up for a club game on Sunday, and be on deck at 7 a.m. Monday morning for a job laying bricks. We can recall when training was Tuesday and Thursday nights, and a drink at the pub afterwards was statutory. We knew Norm Proven when he would go to work at 7 a.m. on a Saturday, work through to about 1 p.m., then head off to the cricket ground to play the match of the day. He won 10 rugby league premierships on that routine. We can remember the players of the Australian and West Indies cricket teams fighting fierce battles in that remarkable 1960-61 series, then sitting down together afterwards at a meal, seated alternately and chatting on happily into the night. Equally, we remember the battles, the revolutions that came upon sport and the bitterness they inspired. Players on the Australian team bus inquiring, "Which side are you on?" as World Series cricket dramas swirled about them. Rugby league players being handed a cheque for $200,000 with no clue as to what it was for, when the Super League tug-of-war was in full swing. And lately, a revolution of another kind, as cricket and the football codes have seen amazing success with women's competitions, drawing enormous crowd support and television ratings. It has been a remarkable era. We, Ian and Norman, have tried in this book to tell it as we remember it, and as we felt it. The funny, the sad, the good and the bad, and, above all, to paint the picture of what fun it has been. The start of it all. It is often said that life happens while you're making plans, and there is no doubt that early days in journalism involved much happenstance. A less complex world offered plenty of opportunity, but most of it was of the sink or swim variety in newspapers that existed half a century ago in a tough, dynamic environment. The accidental sports writer. Ian Heads. An unfolding tale weaving this way and that through sporting days and, occasionally, a sporting daze, began at a modest rented cottage in Rose Bay in the 1940s. It was there, within a simple suburban post-war existence, that I discovered the appeals of the sporting life. Most often with my great mate from across the road, George Craggan, alongside. My own gradual absorption into the games we play had its roots in family stories, such as that involving my long-departed grandfather, Edward Appleton, a keen cricketer and lover of the game at home in England, who, it was said, had not only shared the playing fields with the towering figure of W.G. Grace, but had actually dismissed the great man in a match in London in the late years of the 19th century. The story may even be true, considering that my grandfather's name does appear in an early Wisden. A further story concerning my cricket-tragic granddad was of him sitting up all night beside the wireless in the Ashes series matches of 1934 and 1938. Also nudging along my growing interest in sport and games was a further mini-legend, one attached to my father George Heads, a flight lieutenant in the Royal Australian Air Force in World War II, who had died on the 7th of June 1944 when his plane, transporting equipment for the Aussie soldiers fighting further north, crashed during a blinding rainstorm near Milne Bay, New Guinea. I was then 16 months old and never knew my father, but I remained heartened by the knowledge that at least he met me once or twice between wartime postings. I would learn little through my childhood years of the events of his life or death. My mother had obviously chosen to close the door on this crushing tragedy and, along with no doubt many other war widows, set out resolutely on a sad solo path to raise her two children. Over the years, she rarely talked of our father, a New Zealander of Scottish and English stock, who had been a wool classer before the war. The silence surrounding such tragedies seemed the Aussie way of somehow managing things back then. Very likely, though, my sister and I didn't ask enough questions either, and that remains a source of regret, one mirrored no doubt in many other families. There is a small sporting connection to my father via a story that surfaced in later years, that my dad had been a dab hand at snooker and billiards. However, these were sporting skills I never inherited, as thoroughly proven in teenage years via continuous poor performances on the green beige at a seedy, and aren't they all, snooker parlour off Cleveland Street in Surry Hills. Despite a school rule strictly barring boys from ever going anywhere near such an establishment, a small group of lads would gather regularly at lunchtimes. Amid some already slick exponents of the art, I was hopeless. There was thankfully more salubrious sporting stuff in my life, strengthening the platform of earlier years. And G. Craggan and I would be in the thick of it. Sometimes tennis head-to-head on one of the nearby courts you could hire for a few bob, or a hit of cricket up adjoining South Head Cemetery at Christensen Park, from whose clifftops you could see whales heading up the coast in season. My uncles Sess, Reg and Ken Appleton helped build the framework around a sports-mad kid. There was shared turf with them, feeding my own growing interest, including an occasional hit of cricket in the backyard. A memorable beginning to my personal suffusion into the ways of the sporting life was the occasion of a gloomy Saturday afternoon in a saturated winter, on which Ken and Cecil gathered me up and took me along to the third and deciding test match of the 1950 Rugby League Ashes series, Australia versus Great Britain, played on the hallowed turf, well, hallowed mud, actually, of the Sydney Cricket Ground. A week of torrential rain had almost drowned Sydney, and many tons of river sand had been spread over the field to make it more or less playable. A quagmire rather than a lake. Australia had not won a test series against Mother England since 1920. But in this season, hope was abroad. The Aussies had fought back to take the second test 15-3 in Brisbane after losing the first 6-4. I was 7 years old, and my memories of a famous battle are limited to a handful of shining moments that struggled out of the mud on that rainy mire of a day. In a crowded ground, the three of us stood aside the old SCG Hill scoreboard at the southeastern end. I remember most clearly men nearby pressing long-neck beer bottles into the soft ground and standing on them to improve the view. The sense of a relentless, slogging struggle as the play ground its way up and down the field in a great muddy clump of unrecognisable footballers. Then, late in the gloom, a moment which sent an electric thrill surging through the vast crowd as the ball sped east-west across the Australian backline, ending in the hands of a big fella over the other side, posted on the one strip of green grass visible. With the teams locked to all, he sped for the corner, dived and scored. A mighty roar went up. I would later come to know his name as well as my own, writing many times of Ron Roberts and his uncertain hands, and how he caught the one that mattered and scored arguably the most famous try in Australian rugby league history. The indelible memory of the afternoon is of men dancing on the far touchline and of hats flying in the air at full time in a joyous and spectacular postscript. Australia had won the game 5-2 and claimed the Ashes. The drought had broken in more ways than one, and I had experienced my first day at a big-time sporting event. I have little doubt that the fragmented memories from the passion and excitement of that afternoon, which remain with me today, laid a foundation stone for what lay ahead. Before long, I had developed a growing interest in boxing, a sport which was strong in Australia at that time, especially in the progress of the good-looking and admirable Indigenous middleweight ace Dave Sands, the inspirational figure in a family of fighting men. Sands became my first sporting hero, and, too soon, my first sporting tragedy. It was the Tuesday morning of the 12th of August 1952 when I glimpsed the front-page story in the Sydney Morning Herald, set low down on the page and recording Dave Sands' death the previous evening in a road accident near Dungog. I cried that morning. He was the driver of a 5-ton truck which had overturned, carrying 15 people, and Sands, 26, was the only fatality. The Sands tragedy of 52 touched me as much or more than anything I would encounter in the long building years of sporting attachment. I would learn much later that I shared that hero worship of Sands with the larger-than-life Indigenous rugby league forward, Arthur Beetson. It was many years later, while sharing a plate of chocolate biscuits in a backyard home office with Artie, a champion of the game, that we first discovered our common ground in Dave Sands and his bittersweet story. The big bloke and I were working on a book telling of his life and extraordinary career. Arthur said, "Sands was a special favourite of my dad's and mine," and went on to recount how he and his father Bill, an ex-boxer, would sit together beside the radio in the family home in Roma, Queensland, and listened to broadcasts of all the big fights from Sydney, recalling how the great fighter's death was a shattering event for us. That day, Beetson shared a yarn that perhaps offered solace to us both. He recounted how earlier that year he had driven to Dungog with his partner Anne as a gesture to all those years before. Beetson remembered, "We headed on that day from Dungog to Macquarie Town, to a pub where we stopped for a drink. A Koori bloke a bit older than me struck up a conversation there, during which I told him I had just been to Dungog because of Dave Sands. He then told me a story, that as a 17-year-old, he had been with Sands on the night he died, and that Sands had not had a single drink. Because he was to drive a truck ferrying a number of people home, the boxing champ had stayed away from the booze. But something happened out on the road that night, and the truck hit a bridge. Said Beetson, "It was remarkable all those years down the track how reassuring that news was. How my hero had been doing the right thing that night, and fate's unpredictable hand had been the villain." The book quoted here is Big Artie, published in 2004 and again in a special edition in 2011, the year Arthur fell off his pushbike on a morning ride and died on a Gold Coast road. The news that morning sent the sporting world into disbelief and deep mourning. Uncle Sess had helped add a further notch to my widening sporting interests, taking me along in the summer of 51 to the deciding day of the Davis Cup final between Australia and the United States at White City. Perched close to the play in the specially constructed temporary grandstand, we watched a thrilling afternoon unfold. Australian left-hander Mervyn Rose fell to the American Ted Schroeder, leaving the cup tie balanced at 2-2. Then the Aussie ace Frank Sedgman swept onto the court with his crinkly ordered hair and impeccable style and proceeded to blast vexatious Offutt in straight sets. Australia had won the cup. A faint memory is again of hats flying in the air at the end. Years later, I would learn that Uncle Sess had paid more than 30 shillings for each ticket, a small fortune in hard post-war days. In 1956 came the giant leap, when my mother secured a leave pass from school for me and dispatched me to Melbourne to attend the first week of the Olympic Games, a story told in later pages here. When it came to life direction taken, there was perhaps something preordained about our family, considering the number of next-generation kids in a large family. I was one of 10 cousins, and the following generation who drifted towards the media and its satellites, suggesting there was something in the water when it came to the Appleton clan. The idea was aired lightly now and then that the link harked all the way back to a popular English author of early years of the 20th century, George Manville Fenn, a relative of ours of indeterminate linkage. G. Manville Fenn wrote popular adventure books for boys that sported captivating titles such as Off to the Wilds, Cutlass and Cudgel, and Jungle and Stream. Tomes which opened with such tempting morsels as "We've done wrong, Van. There'll be a jolly row about it." I never did find out what Van had done. Scraping together an undistinguished leaving certificate pass at Sydney Boys High in 1960, I headed out into the world. My modest reference from SBHS, signed by Headmaster Ken Andrews, offered the thought that the police force, or perhaps the insurance industry, were suitable fits for me. I tucked the document swiftly into a drawer and instead, I latched onto a passing cliché and followed my heart, jagging a copyboy's job at Sir Frank Packer's Daily Telegraph in early 1961 at £4 a week. And from there, heading onward into the colourful landscape of the newspaper game. Then, deeper still, tagging along on the end of a colourful line of journos and commentators recording the passing parade of Australian sport, and eventually never searching for a way out. The newspaper world that I stumbled into in the 60s was an old-fashioned place of hot metal and long dinner breaks at the pub next door, of late deadlines and ancient typewriters and smoky editorial rooms strewn with screwed-up copy paper, the detritus of each day. It was tough and exciting and challenging, but I had the sense quite early that maybe this was going to be the pathway to my future. In a slowly unfolding career, haltingly begun, lay glittering prizes unimagined. The chance to attend and cover Olympic Games, 5, bruising kangaroo and World Cup tour campaigns in England and France, great swimming events, Davis Cup tennis, football grand finals, world records, test matches and much more. Now, late arriving in the second half of a longer game, this book, tackled in the company of a great mate from long ago telegraph days, Norm Tasker, offers the chance for the pair of us, while memory permits, to more widely share secrets and near-forgotten yarns that backdropped great sporting days, to chart a course down the track of both distant triumphant days and ones of sadness, and to recall the shards of humour that seemed never too far away. Through all those years, there would be the occasional surprising and welcome teary or lump-in-the-throat moment, such as in Moscow, 1980, when a dogged freestyle distance swimmer from Maroubra, Max Metzger, toughed it out in a brilliantly executed swim to take the Olympic 1500 metres freestyle bronze medal behind the Russian champion Vladimir Selnikov. Metzger had nowhere near the speed or natural talent of Selnikov, the greatest distance swimmer of his generation, but fought every inch to the wall, passing two other swimmers in a never-say-die surge of which he remains proud to this day. It was his finest ever swim, its foundation being a deeply painful formula of unrelenting hard work and guts. It confirmed a deep truth, that sometimes in sport the prize doesn't just go to the winner. Years later came soaring moments of emotion and magic at Sydney's Blue Skies Games, such as when Cathy Freeman and Louise Sauvage, both of them carrying the crushing weight of national expectation on their shoulders, won gold medals magnificently on the red track of the great new stadium. For an uncertain, sports-mad boy who had stumbled into the colourful landscape of the newspaper game in 61, this all seemed to have turned out rather nicely. Journalism. What's that? Norman Tasker. Journalism was never part of the plan. Truth be known, when decisions about a working life had to be made in my final year at school, I wasn't even sure what journalism was. I had planned to be a school teacher. It was the way it was at North Sydney Boys High in the 1950s. You became a doctor, a lawyer, an accountant, an engineer, or a teacher. I chose teacher, but that meant a couple of years at teachers' college, and as events transpired, it was 2 years I could not afford. In the June of 1958, my father became critically ill. The type 1 diabetes he had battled since he was 13 finally caught up with him. His kidneys failed, and since dialysis and other modern interventions that can prolong life were still a long way off, the portents were bad. He died on Australia Day 1959, a week after his 40th birthday. We knew it was coming. He had been a good and gentle man, a wood machinist who worked hard and built us a couple of houses. For my mother, my two young brothers, my baby sister and I, it was a devastating blow. Given that he had been uninsurable, the house still had to be paid off and money was in short supply, I needed to get a job. Ron Nicol was a schoolmate who I knew planned to go into journalism. He finished up a respected news executive with the Sydney Morning Herald. "What do journalists do?" I inquired of him sheepishly. He said something about newspaper reporters, and that was enough to inspire me to seek out the school careers advisor. I explained my predicament. "What about journalism?" I asked knowingly. "Son," he responded with a sympathetic shake of his head, "if there's one thing you could never be, it's a journalist." He sounded pretty convincing, so I abandoned the idea. In the meantime, a neighbour had been talking to my mother about what came next, as the distress of my father's final weeks built. I had mentioned journalism to my mother before the careers advisor got to me. She mentioned it to the neighbour, who saw an ad for a copy boy in the Daily Telegraph and took it upon herself to apply on my behalf. Off I went to the interview, and before I knew it, my career path had been sorted. The education was rapid and intense. Copy boys were the lowest of the low, messengers, tea makers, and targets. One of the key responsibilities was to clear the sub-editor's baskets and send the copy via a compressed air-driven chute to the composing floor, where it was transformed via molten metal into impressions for print. It meant a lot of interaction around the sub-editor's table. The sub-editors of the late 1950s were a crusty bunch. Many of them were World War II veterans, and there was a hard-drinking, down-to-earth culture that required that men be men. It was a very male-oriented place, although I do remember a 19-year-old Ita Buttrose confined, as all women seemed to be then, to the social pages. There was nothing soft about those blokes on the subs table. They expressed themselves forcefully, especially when you were slow to do their bidding. They would yell, "Boy!" at the tops of their lungs, and you knew you had better be on hand quick smart or else. They were hard lessons, but in retrospect, they were good lessons. At the time, though, I was at the point of rebellion, and a cadetship in journalism came in the nick of time. The copy boy experience had its distractions. Sir Frank Packer was the boss in those days, and Saturday nights especially were always interesting. Sir Frank had an aura about him that left us all terrified, and when he came back from the races on Saturday with a modicum of hard liquor aboard, you'd better watch out. The famous story of him throwing money at a young fellow in the lift who was there to deliver a telegram shouting, "You're sacked!" is quite credible if you experienced those Saturday nights. There was another famous night when Sir Frank lurched into the sub-editor's room, half-climbed onto their big semicircular desk, held up a copy of the Sunday Telegraph first edition, then ripped it in half and threw the pieces in the air. "Do it again!" he roared. They did. Young Kerry, then well short of the era that made him a legend, was the second son behind elder brother Clyde, and his old man seemed to have little faith in his future. Kerry was about 22, and though he was a familiar presence around the office, he was never taken particularly seriously. That all changed, of course. Kerry never seemed to do much, but he was always on for a chat about the footy. He would venture into the sporting room, sit on a desk and discuss the rights and wrongs of the latest footy scandal with anyone who cared to listen. One of the most exciting things a copy boy could get to do was to work in police rounds. The job there entailed, among other things, monitoring the police radio to alert the reporter on duty as to what was happening around town. The daily routine also required multiple calls to various police stations with the standard line, "Anything doing?" The reply usually was, "Nothing doing, Telly." But the routine was never broken. One of the old-time police roundsmen was Alec Boyd, who seemed about 90 to 16-year-old me. He'd certainly been about long enough to have experienced the Sydney scene of the 1920s and 1930s, when razor gangs were in business and crime of the underbelly type was at its most rampant. Alec got plenty of interesting calls. One of the more regular was from a lady who announced herself with great decorum and whose calls always commanded Alec's sharp attention. "This is Mrs. Matilda Parsons," she would declare with that roof-of-the-mouth cadence in vogue with European royalty and English aristocracy. "May I please speak with Alec?" Mrs. Matilda Parsons was better known as Tilly Devine, a madam who ran an enterprise in Palmer Street, East Sydney, into the 1960s. Her notoriety in the razor gang days made her an historic Sydney figure. Crime had been her business, and Tilly would have known as much about what was going on in the Sydney underworld as anybody. Alec paid her for news tips, and the supply was endless. On another famous occasion, I was working the overnight shift, 8 p.m. to 3 a.m. This was always an adventure, not least the challenge of getting home. I would catch a lift on one of the paper trucks that delivered the Daily Telegraph through Sydney's northern suburbs, and though the trip was long and arduous, it had a certain character. It was a bit of a contrast to Saturday nights, when I would finish at 11 p.m. and the lift home was usually courtesy of the Sunday Telegraph editor, Johnny Moyes, a kind and considerate boss who gave me many insights into the world I was entering. It was on one of these graveyard shifts that the message came over the police radio that two men who had escaped from Long Bay Jail, Kevin John Simmons and Leslie Allen Newcomb, had been sighted around French's Forest in Sydney's north, not far from where I lived. "Come on," invited the reporter. "Watch how we do it and we'll drop you home." A prison guard had been killed and the manhunt had become a major Sydney preoccupation in the days when newspapers were most people's source of information. I took off with the reporter and photographer in the black police rounds car with an aerial on the roof that seemed to claim all sorts of privileges. I felt very important. It's funny the things you remember. I remember it turned out that Simmons and Newcomb were nowhere near French's Forest. The reporters and photographers spent most of their time in the pub, and I remember a very polished Richie Benno, then Australia's cricket captain, taking notes in his day job as a police reporter for The Sun. Strictly speaking, I wasn't old enough to be legally in the pub with those hard-nosed characters, but I was old enough to help them out when it mattered. More than once, when I alerted the reporters to a message that had come over the police radio, they would tell me, "Get the details and write it." They would advise who to ring and how to go about it. I learned more in a few months with those blokes than any university could teach. I had my first story published while I was still a copy boy and not yet 17. And once I had one under my belt, they seemed to follow in waves. I remember the thrill of getting on the front page with a story about a multiple surf rescue at North Curl Curl, I might not have known much about journalism when I started, but it didn't take long to get hooked. The cadetship came quickly, and with it an early taste of adult life and its important battles. Covering council meetings was a routine. I was at Warringah Council when a vote was taken to allow a shopping centre at Brookvale, now the vast Warringah Mall. I also remember covering a meeting of North Shore Council mayors when there was an uprising against the state government because they had decided to raise the toll on the Sydney Harbour Bridge from sixpence to a shilling, 10 cents. It is amazing how much history is written in 60 years. At Kurungai Council one night, I was a bit flummoxed when Mayor Harry Jago, later a New South Wales government minister who lost his job when he forgot to formally nominate for an election, invited me for drinks with the council after a meeting. As a 17-year-old non-drinker, I felt like a fish out of water, especially when the mayor insisted on calling me Mr. Tasker. Through all of this, the education was strong and the disciplines rigid. The Telegraph in those days operated according to a strict style established by a former editor, Brian Penton. A sentence was decreed to contain no more than 22 words. It would have one verb. Everything was to be active voice. The bus ran over the cat. Never, the cat was run over by a bus. Adjectives and adverbs, if not actually banned, were to be used only when absolutely necessary. The word I was barred, as was, for the most part, anything that resembled a personal opinion. Accuracy was paramount. In telling any story, the facts were all that mattered. At the risk of breaking a few rules and offering an opinion, it seems to me that journalism and society as a whole could benefit today from such strictures. Media that mattered. When the authors made their start in journalism, newspapers mattered. They were bustling hives of high activity, well-funded, well-supported, and the premier means of public communication. Much has changed. But remembering the people and the way it was seems as important now as it did then. Frank Packer and the Way It Was. Norman Tasker. Frank Packer knew what he liked. And if you worked for him at the start of the 1960s, you'd better like it too. As owner of the Telegraph and Channel 9, Frank was not averse to indulging himself. There's a famous story of a long Sunday lunch at home with some of his mates when a horse he owned was featured on Nine's Sunday sports program. They watched it run. Then, caught up in the excitement of it all, Frank rang the control room to get it played again. And again, leaving the presenters at Willoughby at wit's end trying to explain to everybody else watching why so many replays. He was a bit like that with the telly too, and sport of a particular kind was one of his passions. He was a committee man at the Australian Jockey Club, and he took particular delight in the boxing matches that were required for young apprentice jockeys. As a fledgling reporter, all of 17 years old, I was assigned to cover them, and warned that I had better be on the ball. It was a weird thing, watching these tiny boys of tender years belting the daylights out of each other, but Frank and his mates were richly entertained. The coverage, of course, was positive, though in truth the young boxers were gearing themselves for much more dangerous action, so there was some method to the madness. Sir Frank also had a thing for the polo. The Royal Easter Show, at the old showground next to the SCG in those days, was a big deal. Its highlight, as far as Frank was concerned, was the Daily Telegraph Gold Cup, in which polo teams from all over rural New South Wales and Queensland took part. I had to cover that too, and again the patronage of the boss meant it was a high-pressure assignment. Needless to say, I knew little about polo. I thought a chucker was a cricketer who bowled with a bent arm. But I learned fast, since these polo games commanded extraordinary space in the early pages of the paper, despite the fact that very few people would have been interested. It was not the number who were interested that mattered, of course, but who they were. Names like Bob Skeen and Sinclair Hill, Peter Cudmore and Hector King were in their own way rural aristocracy, and the polo at the show brought them together in battles royal that were a delight to Frank Packer. I remember having to ring Sam Horden about something or other. Horden was president of the Royal Agricultural Society and a member of an iconic Sydney family whose forebears had run the Anthony Horden Retail Company. Sam asked me if I wouldn't mind thanking Sir Frank for his support of the polo. I thought that was weird. It wasn't as if I was having a drink with Frank every Friday night. The polo, though, taught me a lot about covering sport quickly and under pressure. I'd swiftly gathered some sport reporting experience too by other means. In my last year at school, I broke my arm playing rugby. And while it was in plaster, I began refereeing. Through 1959, I refereed a lot of school games, given weekend work allowed me the time midweek, and another of those school referees was the Telegraph's senior cricket and rugby writer, Phil Tresidder. He noticed my name and asked if I would like to cover a Saturday game as a casual. Would I? Within 3 months of starting as a copy boy, I was covering a rugby game every Saturday. A tragedy close to our family also played a part in my eventual concentration on sports journalism. Ken Murray was a 13-year-old neighbour who was a mate of my brother Peter and a frequent visitor to our house in Forestville. Ken went swimming under the Roseville Bridge in Middle Harbour on a weekend in early 1960 and was taken by a shark. He was severely mauled, having lost a leg and part of his lower abdomen, and died a few days later. The Murrays lived not far from us, and I was appalled by the press cars that seemed always to be at their house in those early days after the attack, when the distress that Ken's mother was feeling is hard to imagine. It was a form of foot-in-the-door journalism that seemed predatory to me, an invasion of privacy in a heartless, unthinking sort of way. I didn't want to ever be involved in that sort of reporting. The call to sport came soon after, and I have to say it was a great relief. At the start, I was the new boy on the block, a jack-of-all-trades who did the jobs nobody wanted to do. The cycling at Wiley Park on a Saturday night, and the speedway at the showground on Saturday nights as well, became a part of my routine. For a late teenager, it was a bit cramping socially, and the weekend work meant as well that I couldn't really play sport as others did. It was the price you paid. It was a classic sports staff in those days. Tresidder, about 31 then, I guess, had taken himself off to Britain as a 19-year-old and managed to score himself jobs as a travelling correspondent with the 1947-48 Wallabies, Bradman's 1948 Invincibles cricket tour, the 1948 London Olympics, and the 1948-49 Kangaroo Rugby League tour. By the time he was 21, he was as seasoned a sports writer as any in the business. Phil was in charge of the cricket and the rugby. George Crawford was the league man and had been for years. Jack Pollard, later a prolific author of encyclopedic sports books, was his offsider and did the tennis too. Robert Gray, later an iconic cricket writer, was a sort of roustabout. Jeff Prenter and myself, and later Ian Heads, were the kids in the office. In the days before the TAB, racing was big too. Keith Robbins seemed to lead the charge with Neville Prendergast, Ray Alexander, later boss of the AJC, and Jack Lawson locked in behind him. Jock Schofield was the Sunday telly man, and CJ Daddy Graves was an eccentric columnist and trackwork guru. Graves had been a turf rider since the 1920s, and his column, Being the Musings of a Gentleman Upon the Turf, written in something akin to Jane Austen's English, was something else. As the 1950s gave way to the 1960s, the conservative mores of the immediate post-war years had not yet been pushed aside. I remember three specific issues in those days that became sport's great controversies. The first of them was whether sport should be allowed to be played on Sundays. The second was whether sporting bodies should allow their games to be televised. And the third, less in impact but no less stark against the trends of today, was whether the lovely picket fence around the Sydney Cricket Ground should be defiled by advertisements. It all seems quaint now, but at the time Sunday was still a family day. A lot of people still went to church, and the Sunday lunchtime roast was an entrenched tradition. As for the sport on television, then in its infancy in Australia, there was enormous fear among the league, the cricket and the rest, that allowing their games to be beamed into homes would give people an easy out. They just wouldn't come to the matches, and since this was the source of all their income, it would be a calamity. The sale of television rights, now the bounty that keeps sport going, was simply never considered then. As to the SCG and the picket fence, well, putting ads on that was just not on. The world was changing for sure, but that sort of modern humbug, driven by crass commercialism, was simply a bridge too far. There at the start, Norman Tasker. The 60 years or so from which the sporting tales in this book have accumulated were years of great change, and inevitably, we happened upon a lot of firsts. The biggest change to influence sport in that time was the advent of Australian television in 1956. Coverage of sport was low-key to start, but accelerated markedly when colour television began in 1974. Television moguls, notably Kerry Packer and Rupert Murdoch, saw a big quid in it, and suddenly the happy pastimes of old became massive public entertainment, and everything was different. I was on hand for four of those firsts. Television arrives. In the early winter of 1957, while still a schoolboy, I was at Chatswood Oval in Sydney when the ABC pioneered weekly live sporting television coverage. The outside broadcast van set up for the local rugby game between Gordon and Manly. Television had begun in Australia in September 1956 in time for coverage of the Melbourne Olympic Games. But Chatswood 1957 was the first sortie into regular local coverage. Chatswood was one of the few venues they could manage in those fledgling times, since they needed a direct microwave link to their transmitter in Artarmon. Happily, Gordon were the premiers anyway. The first match to be covered on live television was the reserve grade game that day with commentator Norman May. It was practice for the television crews. Dick Healy, later Minister for Health in a New South Wales government, was the lead commentator for the first grade game. Club rugby has been a Saturday staple on TV virtually ever since. One day cricket. In the summer of 1970-71, I was covering an Ashes cricket series in Australia when the third test in Melbourne was washed out. Bill Laurie and Ray Illingworth had tossed, but that was as far as they got, and eventually the match was abandoned. To keep some faith with the crowd, a one-day match of 40 overs per side was hastily arranged, the first ever one-day international. Nobody thought of it as a trailblazing move. It was just an expedient to fill a day. The players played in whites and gave no real thought as to how to adjust to a shorter game. Jeff Boycott opened for England and Bill Laurie for Australia. No Joss Butler or Glenn Maxwell here, rather a couple of stay puts of the old school. England set Australia 191 to win, and thanks to an Ian Chappell innings of 60, they got there with half a dozen overs to spare. The big news of the match was that 46,000 people turned up to watch it, astonishing the game's administration and sowing the seeds of a whole new outlook for international cricket. TV goes national. That 1970-71 series also was a turning point in television coverage of international cricket, when the second test in Perth, the first ever in Perth as well, became the first to be available on a fully national basis. In the days before satellites, coaxial cable had been laid and the ABC was able to line up all the major cities to cover major events. That Perth test saw the introduction of Greg Chappell to the Australian team, and he obliged with a maiden century, allowing him to proclaim afterwards that now he need no longer be Victor Richardson's grandson or Ian Chappell's brother. Now I can be Greg Chappell. Somewhat marring this first national broadcast was the decision of an East Coast producer to cut off the coverage and switch to the local news when Chappell the Younger was on the cusp of his century. National uproar followed. And then international. Such was the rampant technological advance in television through the 1970s. A satellite in space had become a reality, and the first international coverage of a test match was possible. I was there for that too, at The Oval in 1972, when Ian Chappell's team scored a dramatic final test victory to square the Ashes series 2-2 and begin a new and exciting era in the Australian game. It all seems quite antiquated now, looking back on those black and white pictures on a small screen, but it was mind-boggling advancement at the time, and indication enough that the sedate old game of another time would never be the same again. Dark Arts of the Ghostwriter, Norman Tasker. The dark arts of ghostwriting have always been a sports writer's lot, more so in recent times as the cult of celebrity has taken hold in sport. In its simplest form, It is the easiest way of turning a high-profile sportsman's thoughts and emotions into some sort of coherent output. I've done plenty of it through newspapers, magazines, and books, and so has just about everybody else who has worked at sports writing for any length of time. The first sportsman I had to ghost was Ken Killer Carney, the rugby league captain coach who set St George on their remarkable path to 11 straight premierships through the 1950s and 1960s. Carney had recently retired as Saints captain coach after leading them to the first six of their premierships. It was 1962. Carney was now coaching Parramatta, and it had fallen to me to help him with a Saturday column he did each week for Frank Packer's Daily Telegraph. The routine required that we meet on Friday afternoon at the King's Head Hotel near the Telegraph office. As a non-drinking 19-year-old at the time, this represented a challenge in itself, since drinking was one thing the killer could do with abundant enthusiasm. Returning to the office in the early evening to transfer Carney's thoughts to paper required fierce concentration to rise above the haze into which he regularly sent me. It was one of many lessons in life I had from the killer. Carney was a remarkable man. He had been seconded to the RAF in World War II and flew as a navigator in bombing missions over Germany. He had been the test match hooker in Trevor Allen's highly successful Wallaby tour through Britain in 1947-48. He had played four seasons of league with Leeds in Northern England, then gone home to join the Saints and reshape their whole attitude to rugby league. In the book The Gladiators, which I wrote with Norm Proven and Arthur Summons in 2013, Proven makes no bones about the fact that the great St George era was built on Carney's nous, toughness and persistence, and the culture he brought to the club. He got them fitter than anybody else. He changed their outlook to forward domination and made them feared. And he taught them to think, introducing much of the creative subtlety then the basis of English football. He was helped, of course, by the smarts of club secretary Frank Facer, who gathered for the club champions of the ilk of John Raper, Kevin Ryan, Reg Gasnier, Graham Langlands, Harry Bath, Billy Smith, and others. But it was Carney who set the on-field standards that made Saints a powerhouse. He taught me a lot on those Friday afternoons, about sport and about life as well. He had been captain coach of the 1956 Kangaroos, and he gave me one of his tour jerseys, a prickly woolen thing that spoke of another time. It was an enduring memento of Fridays with Killer. Part of the science of successful ghostwriting is to put yourself into the head of the person whose words you are reflecting. The best example of this for me was the time when I wrote a bunch of scripts for the television program This Is Your Life. I would imagine the words expressed in the voice of Roger Climpson, the then host of the show, and try to make them sound like him. Similarly, when I wrote a series of books for the renowned ABC cricket broadcaster Alan McGilvray, I would try to find words that he used all the time, to make him sound like himself, in other words. Some were a little more difficult. The most difficult of all was Jack Gibson, the masterful rugby league coach with whom I wrote columns in Rugby League Week for a couple of seasons. Gibson was the master of the cliché, the mixed metaphor, the vague innuendo, and the in-joke. Unquestionably, he had a head full of the most involved sporting knowledge and a down-to-earth command of man management. But half the time you didn't have a clue what he was talking about. I always figured he must have confused his players much of the time and managed large parts of his success through pure fear, for certainly he was a very commanding figure. His theories and his analyses were uttered in a clipped jargon that often proffered rare comedy in his television commentaries, but his one-liners were hard to make work on paper. So when you wrote for Jack Gibson, you kept it clipped, short, basic, and very much to the point. He still came out with plenty of gems and insights that were simply extraordinary, once you worked them out. Writing columns with the inimitable Ray Price, as I did for some years at Rugby League Week, was a unique experience. Ray was a champion footballer in both rugby codes. They called him Mr. Perpetual Motion for the sheer industry of his game. He was a member of four premiership teams with Parramatta, and he was universally respected as a totally fearless footballer. Price was pretty fearless with his opinions too. He never held back, and the key to working with him was as much about calming him down as anything else. Ray ran his life much as he ran his football, fearlessly, aggressively, and with a certain wild abandon. I had made a wallaby tour of Britain with Price and knew him well by the time I started writing with him. I knew all about his courage and his determination, and that he had a mind of his own, which he was very ready to speak. He was, of all the sportsmen I have met, in the very top echelon of those you would have in the trenches with you. Price played the early part of that wallaby tour with an undiagnosed hernia. He discovered it reading a magazine in a doctor's surgery while seeking treatment for something else. The article talked of lumps and symptoms, and Price realized his problem. He missed many weeks of the tour after surgery, but only half as many as he was supposed to. When he returned, he badly broke his hand and tried unsuccessfully to keep it secret. Even then, he returned before the tour was over to play in the inaugural test against the United States in Anaheim. Price maintained the passion of his football days pretty much through life. I can remember conversations with him in his 50s when he was playing classic Wallabies matches against the classic All Blacks. He was going to kill this bloke and flatten that bloke and settle scores from 30 years before. "Ray," I would caution, "these are social games and you're all in your 50s. You can't go bashing people." "Bullshit," he would reply, "they're all New Zealanders." He was much the same with his columns. Bashing people was what he did. When Gary Jack, Balmain's international rugby league fullback, volunteered a few opinions to Rugby League Week about his coach Alan Jones, the piece was ghostwritten by RLW staff member Matthew Gunn. Jones had coached the Australian rugby team very successfully through the mid-1980s and volunteered to coach Balmain at the end of Warren Ryan's tenure in 1990. He had no experience of rugby league, but reckoned it would be easy. A couple of years in, Gary Jack begged to differ. The column that he and Matthew put together broadly made the point that Jones knew little about rugby league and hadn't managed to weld the team together, while Balmain's results remained in spiralling chaos. As often was the case with Jones, half the team loved him and were violently opposed to Jack's view, and the other half were totally on board with it. I was the managing editor of Rugby League Week at the time, and when I read the column submitted for publication, there was no doubt in my mind as to the reaction to it, especially from Jones. I rang Gary Jack and went through it with him line by line. He was happy with all of it, adamantly so. It was a Friday afternoon. The magazine deadline was Monday night. I discussed with Jack the consequences that might follow for a player in his position, but he didn't care. I suggested he think about it over the weekend and we would talk again Monday morning. If he still wanted to do it, fine. By Monday morning, nothing had changed. "Do it," he said. The piece caused the predictable stir, but I don't recall Jones ever having a go at the magazine. I had been expecting fire and fury, but it never came. Intermediaries let me know of his disapproval, and I got the message back to him that he could have a page to reply if he wanted. He never did. I've known Alan Jones for more than 40 years, since long before he got involved either in serious rugby coaching or radio. And while I have had many strong arguments with him, we generally get on well. He is a complex man who does much good, but can create a fair bit of mayhem through the ferocity and inflexibility of his opinions, and his undoubted influence on powerful people is often resented. When I was in England with the Australian cricket team in 1977, Jones was studying at Oxford, and he invited me to a madrigal at one of the Oxford colleges. The medieval music was captivating, and the environs equally so. I remembered that madrigal when the Gary Jack thing hit and marvelled at the incongruity of it all. A medieval concert seemed hardly the sort of thing that fitted with the knockabout nature of the Balmain Tigers, the original working man's club. While at Oxford, I finished up having a few beers with Jones at a pub on the banks of the Isis River, as the Thames is called as it flows through the university city. Jones told me he wanted to be the Australian treasurer. Not prime minister, just treasurer. He finished up much more powerful than that. 2 minutes with Gandhi. Ian Heads. It was a fortunate arrival into the sports writing caper in the early 1960s that swept me into a land of giants, providing the chance to mix with and learn from some of the finest sporting scribes in the business, some of them with pedigrees that stretched back impossibly far to sporting heroes of early years of the 20th century. Norm Tasker and I each would benefit hugely from lessons learned from the likes of the colourful lineup profiled below and plenty of others, including the hard-nosed, blunt-spoken sub-editors of old newspaper days. The wisdom of the elders provided a journalistic masterclass to set us on our way. Tom Goodman was the doyen of his time, a gentleman and a gentleman, who, born in 1902, spanned sports and sports writing from around 1914, holding through his life a faint memory of having, as a 12-year-old, been at rugby league's famous Rorke's Drift Test, England versus Australia, of 1914. I never worked with Tom, being originally on the opposition morning paper. After early days on the old Sydney paper, The Evening News, Tom's home base had been at the Sydney Morning Herald. The question of rivalry never mattered.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.